Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service of Holy Communion here at St. Mary Magdalene with St. Martin in East Croydon. Welcome to all of you who are at home watching and joining online with our service today. Just a verse from the psalm for this morning, which is Psalm 72. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous things. Blessed be his glorious name forever. May his glory fill the whole earth. Amen and amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. We stand to sing our first hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy. Let's stand together if we can. Would you like to be seated as we come to pray and to confess our sin before God? Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. There are no other commandments greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Therefore, let us now confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. We pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We stand to sing the Gloria together. And the collect for this Sunday, we pray together. Almighty Father, whose Son was revealed in majesty before he suffered death upon the cross, give us grace to perceive his glory, that we may be strengthened to suffer with him and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Would you like to be seated as we have our first reading and second reading brought to us by Wenton?
Reading is taken from Exodus chapter 24. Beginning to read at verses 12 to the end. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait here. I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses set out with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up onto the mountain of God. To the elders he said, "Wait here for us until we come back to you. Look, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. And the seventh day he called to Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the Israelites. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel reading. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 to 9. The Transfiguration. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became bright as light. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah, talking with them. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will set up three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, the beloved, with whom I'm well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they raised their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Morning, everyone. Please be seated. Shall we pray as we begin to look at God's word? Father God, we thank you for this beautiful morning. We thank you for the privilege of gathering here. Help us to appreciate what a privilege it is. When we look around the world, many do not have this privilege. So open our hearts and our minds to hear what you are saying to us, to each one of us, this morning. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So, this morning we have the story of the Transfiguration. Now, I don't know about you, but if I were to choose a toy, Transformers would not be top of my list. Yet over the years, I have gone from shop to shop searching for these kinds of toys as they appeared frequently on the children's birthday Christmas list. I must say, I do like watching how one toy can be changed from one toy to three different toys in one. And I really do like watching the children really transform these little toys from either a car into a motorbike, into a boat, and so forth and so on. I think they're great things. Now today, we have the story of the Transfiguration. It's often said that Jesus was transfigured, meaning that he was transformed, changed. But what was really going on that day? Was Jesus being changed, or the disciples? And what relevance does this transfiguration have for us today? This story of the Transfiguration is a very familiar one, and it appears in all the three synoptic gospels. In Matthew's account, the Transfiguration comes after Peter's confession of Jesus as the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And after Jesus had told them, the disciples, how he must go to Jerusalem, suffer and die at the hands of the authorities. Jesus takes these three inner circle of friends upon a mountain, and there he is transfigured before them. And Moses and Elijah appear and are talking with Jesus about the coming events of his crucifixion. It's a widely held view that Moses and Elijah represent the law and the prophets. And that is true because Jesus said that he did not come to abolish the law and the prophets, but to fulfill it. Yet the appearance of these two great giants of the Old Testament may have an added relevance. Both of them had mysterious deaths, Moses and on Mount Nebo, and Elijah being taken up to God in chariots of fire. Thus, they became known as the deathless ones. Their appearing with Jesus, talking about the upcoming events of his death and resurrection, may be pointing to the fact that Jesus' death would not be the end. He would rise to join the two deathless ones. By his death and resurrection, Jesus, like Moses, would rescue humanity from its slavery to sin. The transfiguration of Jesus is, as it were, an unveiling. We see Jesus, the eternal one, the deathless one, and in him we see the glory and presence of God. Looked at from this perspective, the transfiguration turns out to be more of a revelation to the disciples of the divinity and glory of Jesus. So they catch a glimpse of who Jesus really is, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Yes, the transfiguration echoes Moses' encounter with God, as we heard on Mount Sinai. There, Moses' face shone to reflect the glory of God. Yet Moses' glory would fade over time. But the glory of Jesus is from eternity and continues into eternity. And the voice coming out of the cloud makes it clear this truth. The disciples hear the very same words that they heard at Jesus' baptism as he began his ministry. There, the Father was endorsing the launch of the Son's earthly ministry. And now, the Father is endorsing the Son as he faces the cross to conclude his earthly ministry. But putting the focus on the disciples to see the glorified Jesus, Matthew seems to be pointing us to the transformation that occurs in these disciples. They catch a glimpse of the glory of Jesus. They see his glory, and they hear it through the Father's voice in the cloud. They can never return down the mountain the same people they came up again. These disciples receive a magnified understanding of Jesus. It seems that the transformation lies more with the disciples from seeing their Jesus glorified. It's encounters such as these and their life with Jesus that would, in the post-resurrection period, compel these disciples to choose to suffer and die for the sake of the gospel. As John would say, referring to Jesus in his epistle, "That which we have was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our own eyes, which we have touched and our own hands have touched, that we have proclaimed to you the word of life. The life appeared, and we have seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you may have fellowship with the Father. And our fellowship is with the Father and the Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete." Those are the words of someone who is totally convinced of what they believe. They had seen, and nothing was going to stop them from proclaiming the good news. So what relevance then does this transfiguration have for people today, for us today? Coming as it does on this Sunday before Lent, what might we take from this story of Jesus being transfigured? Firstly, Jesus had an inner circle of friends with whom he shared some of his deeply personal moments. The transfiguration is one of those moments. Jesus takes with him Peter, James, and John. Jesus is showing us that the power of partnering with others is great. Faith, our faith journey, is not a lone journey. It's not a journey that we travel alone. We travel as fellow pilgrims, helping and supporting one another along the way. Hence, Jesus took these three with him. Secondly, there is the power of affirmation. Jesus is about to enter one of the toughest times at the hands of the religious leaders and eventually be crucified. Just as the Father had affirmed him at the beginning of his ministry, here we have echoes of the same words as Jesus prepares for the cross. This is my Son, whom I love. Listen to him. There is power in affirmation to build and strengthen someone, not only to build and strengthen the one who is being affirmed, but also to build and affirm and strengthen those who are there to witness this affirmation. On hearing God's affirming this son, the disciples would take comfort and assurance and hope for the future, because they've heard from the Father himself. They've heard, they've seen. They are assured that they are following the Son of God, and that assurance would carry them beyond Jesus' resurrection into the Acts of the Apostles, where these once timid disciples would rise to great heights to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. They had seen, they had heard, and they were convinced, and nothing would stop them. And we too have the benefit of their accounts and our own experiences. And like the disciples, this should spur us on to tell the good news of Jesus to those around us. And thirdly, fear can paralyze us. In verse 6, we hear, when the disciples heard this, that is, the voice in the cloud, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and touched them. Get up, he said. Don't be afraid. In this world, there is a lot to instill fear in us. But the presence of Jesus brings us peace and comfort. He comes to us in our darkest moments. He comes and says, do not be afraid. Why? Because he has our backs. He cares for us. He is ultimately in control of the course of history. He has promised never to leave us or forsake us. He is all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-present. He is so powerful that nothing that you and I face is too hard for him. So we can be confident that we have on our side the one who has prevailed over death. We have on our side the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and nothing can touch us apart from God's permission. And fourthly, we have these three disciples alone with their master. And what we learn from this? We learn that as they stay with their master, they receive a revelation. And we too need to spend time with our Lord in prayer, reading scripture, not just reading, meditating on it. God will reveal things to us as we abide in his word. He says in Psalm 25:14, the Lord confides in those who fear him and makes his covenant known to them. So yes, God will reveal things to us. And the revelation we receive will transform us so that we can move from glory to glory. We may not hear audibly the voice of God, although there's nothing to say that we can't. We can hear that voice of God sometimes, but we will catch glimpses of God, and we'll become more sensitive to the Holy Spirit's promptings in our daily lives. We will grow to know the love of God more and more, and this will give us confidence to step out into the world in faith, to take action, to save others. We know that we are serving God, and we serve others because God is with us, and we are assured He will strengthen us. He will give us the resources that we need to conduct His work, to carry out His work. So as we step into this Lent, studying scripture, how might we learn? What is it that we might do? We will meditate on scripture, yes. We will pray. We may choose to fast, to draw closer and closer to God. As we do so, we know that He will draw closer to us. We know that as we spend more time with Him, we will be transformed. And that transformation is sure to impact those around us. Now, only the other day at work, I was speaking to a customer who came in quite agitated and tearful. She didn't want to speak that particular day, but I just said a few words, and she said she would come and have a proper conversation the following day. And when she came into the consultation room, and she said, "Wow, after I spoke to you, I felt a deep sense of peace, and I really haven't got much to say today." And I was so surprised, because I hadn't been feeling great myself, and I didn't think that I had said anything much to her. But of course, it must have been something that she caught that had come from morning time in prayer with God. So as we spend time with God, we may not be aware of it, but something of Him rubs onto us, and people will sense that, although we may not. Like I was on this day, I was absolutely surprised. And she walked out and she was so peaceful, a totally different woman altogether. So yes, something happens to us when we spend time in the presence of our loving Heavenly Father. We all have different ways to connect with the Father, whether it's a walk in the park or up in the hills or washing up or a set corner or place in our house. God is always ready to reveal Himself to us as we seek Him earnestly with our whole hearts. I know He is faithful to His word, and He will reveal things to us. It is my prayer that, like these three disciples on this Mount of Transfiguration, as we spend time in the presence of God this Lent, we will receive new revelation about who God is and be transformed as we discover another aspect of God that we may not have been previously aware of. As we spend more time in God's presence, we take on the image of our Heavenly Father, and we are changed from being self-centered to people-centered, to be more loving, more caring, and more generous. The more time we spend in prayer and scripture, we adopt the image of our Father, and we are transformed into His likeness, and we emerge different people altogether. We too can emerge into the world as instruments of transformation in our families, in our workplaces, in our communities, and in the world at large, bringing hope where there is despair. And indeed, there is so much despair around the world, and we carry the message of hope. We bring comfort where there is pain and suffering and grief, peace where there is anxiety and fear. We have that opportunity to do that, because as we spend time this Lent with our Father, we will receive something from Him, and that something will help us to go out there and touch the world for the kingdom. It's not a question of having more answers or asking more questions. The world is desperately in need of transformation. It doesn't need any more questions or answers. It needs transformation. That transformation can only come through Jesus, and we are channels of God's transforming power. Now may this Lent bring about that transformation in and through us as we go out and meet the world. Amen.
We take a moment to open our hearts to to the word that Regina has brought to us this morning. Thanks. Father, as we step into Lent later on this week, we pray that we may find in this season a time of refreshing as we open our hearts more fully each day to you. We pray, Father, that we may find time to read, time to reflect, time to be still in your presence. And we pray, Father, for that transformation of our society and of our world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would like to, stand as we say together the creed? Let's stand together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Would you like to sit as Frank comes to lead us in our intercessions?
My wife, Sancha, is poorly today, so I've come to read the intercessions that she has written. As Paul writes in his letters to the Philippians, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Lord Jesus, you call us, we come as we are, to worship you. We come with our strengths and our weaknesses, with our hopes and our heartaches. We come as we are, knowing you will welcome us. We come now to pray for the needs of the world. Heavenly Father, endless in power and love, help us to know we can trust in you. Lord, you know our hearts. Guide us on our walk with you, that we may show your love to others, both in the words we speak and in the things we do. Lord, we pray for our church here in Addiscombe, and thank you that it is part of your whole church throughout the world. Keep us always mindful of the greatness and richness of the fellowship to which we belong. We ask for your blessing on Amanda, Regina, Brian, and Anand as they lead us. We pray that you will guide us in our mission to reach out to those in the community. In this secular world, help us to be able to capture the hearts of children and young people so that they may cling to your word and grow in faith, and in so doing, continue the work to make disciples and so to build up your church here on earth. Lord, in your mercy, we praise and thank you for your wonderful creation and for the signs of spring that are beginning to appear around us. Help us to respect and care for your earth so that future generations may enjoy all its natural resources. Let us remember the troubled areas of the world. We pray particularly for the Ukraine, that fighting will cease and peace will reign once more. We pray for the people of Turkey and Syria who have been affected by the terrible earthquake. We ask for your blessing on the injured and those who have lost loved ones. We pray for the doctors and nurses and those who are helping in whatever capacity they can. And we give thanks for the aid agencies and all their work they're doing to help provide food and shelter. We pray for the leaders of the nations, and we ask for your blessing on our own government, and pray that Christian values will be upheld here at all times. We pray for the time when all kingdoms in this world may become your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, we thank you for our neighbours and for the people around us with whom we share our daily lives. We pray for those who are old and lonely, those who are isolated because of ill health, and those who find it difficult to make friends. Show us what we can do to help, and teach us to be good neighbours. As the hymn goes, we are pilgrims on a journey and companions on the road. We are here to help each other walk the mile and bear the load. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to mind those who need your comfort and your healing touch. Let us take a few moments to remember them in our hearts. We pray for all teachers and pupils returning to school. May they feel refreshed and re-energized after the half-term break. We give thanks for the support of our families and friends, for all the encouragement and help they give us. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for all our loved ones who have died and now in your safekeeping. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son. Amen. And may I add a thanksgiving of my own. I now live 5 miles from the church and don't drive, and it is difficult to be supportive of the church in the way that I'd like to be. But I do watch services on the internet. So, dear Father, I would like to give thanks for all those who have provided those services, and the ministry particularly that they have given this week in helping to set up the Noon South system. Dear Father, thank you for them. Amen.
Amen. Shall we stand together to share the peace? When Jesus came and stood amongst his disciples, he said to them, "Peace be with you. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you." We can move around if you'd like to. Share that peace with one another now. We come to prepare for communion and we receive our offerings. Let's sing together our next hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy. Let's stand and sing together. Sorry? A wrong hymn, that's me. Breathe on me, breath of God. I'm one track behind. Lord, we thank you for everything in this world that you have made and that you have given us. And we offer you these gifts now that we may see your name glorified through them. Amen. Thank you, Gina. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. And with your whole church throughout the world, we lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven, saying, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest." And we sit to pray together as Jesus taught us. So we pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. We pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Well, I think that sounded good, don't you? So thank you, Nigel, for all your hard work in ensuring that we have a new sound system. It's its inauguration today. I'm sure you are hearing our voices much more clearly than you had before. You can certainly distinguish between the depths and the heights of our voices very easily now. So shall we give a big round of applause to Nigel for all his hard work? Thank you. We haven't yet received the new part we need for our boiler. So as you can see, the heating is off. We should, I think one hasn't been turned on actually, but we should have the outdoor heaters turned on, which they are on, are they? Behind you, good. If anybody else happens to have any outdoor heaters, these two belong to me, do let us know, because we could do with additional heaters in here just to take the edge off before we begin a service. Excuse me. Gosh, that is very effective. Shrove Tuesday is this Tuesday, and Esther from the Oval Tavern sent me a text early this morning to say that they've just decided, I think you, some of you will know this, that to run the usual community pancake race on Tuesday, which we haven't had for the last 3 years. And St Mary's has always been one of the entries in for this. It's great fun. It's just outside the Oval Tavern. So you do not have to run in the race, but may I invite you to come and join us? Some of us might run. I might possibly do the three-legged race because it's not very long, but I need someone to run it with. It's on Tuesday. And I think it's at 6:30. What we'll do is send out an email to let everybody know, because she didn't send the time to me and she hasn't replied to my query on that. And they also do a wonderful pancakes for everyone to eat. And it's a really good opportunity to actually be amongst people who are living in our parish, who are part of our community. So that's on Tuesday. It's always been at 6:30. I'm just assuming it is, but we will let you know. Come and join in. Come and have a pancake at least and watch me run the three-legged race with perhaps Regina. Maybe not. Maybe with Brian. Brian, you've run it before, haven't you? I think you nearly won 1 year. And then on Ash Wednesday, we have our evening service here at 7:30, just an hour of Holy Communion with Ashing. If you'd like to come to that, please do. And I know some life groups would normally come to that instead of meeting. You meet here together corporately. Let me just find my book. Did I leave it on there? Yes. If you want a recommendation from me, we'll send you out a visual on this, actually, for daily readings during Lent. This is a book I found online. It's very reasonable. I think it cost me £4. I can't remember now. And it's got readings that weeks that are written for by various different Christian leaders. And it's been, I think Paula Gooder is one of them. Paula Gooder is excellent, actually. So you've got every page is a day, and you're given the readings for the day to look through, and in particular one of those readings, and some comment on it with a prayer to pray at the end. So it's called Reflections for Lent with Holy Week Reflections by Paula Gooder. I'll leave that in the hall so you can have a look at it if you want to take a snapshot of it and order it online. It came within a day. I think mine came through that very well-known delivery agency beginning with A. Just check if there's anything else I need to tell you during the course of this week. I think we've got Café Matinée, haven't we, this week? Chris, is that right? Yeah, Café Matinée this Wednesday. Sorry, yeah, wrap up warm. And if you have got, we can't obviously put on too many heaters because we'll blow the system in here, but we could probably survive with four more heaters. If anybody has got some decent outdoor heaters, let us know. So that's this Thursday. Big thank you also from Chris, because so many of you have offered to make sandwiches for the homeless that we don't need any more helpers. So it's not often we have a notice like that. No more helpers needed. You might like to go on a standby list in case somebody at the end isn't able to do their offering. I've got Banns of Marriage to read today. So I publish the Banns of Marriage between Alison Elizabeth Holland of this parish and Charles Benson of the parish of St. Edward's King Confessor of New Addington to be married at St. Luke's Church Woodside due to Alison's qualifying connection there. If you know any reason why Alison and Charles may not marry each other, you are to declare it. Let's pray for them. Father, we thank you for the gift of marriage, and we pray for Alison and Charlie as they prepare for their wedding day, that you will bless them, strengthen their faith, increase their love for one another, and grant them joy on their wedding day. Amen. Let's sing our closing hymn, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Let's stand to sing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.